Throw your bulletin away. Okay, There's a lot of announcements that are in the bulletin. Take it home, look through it, make sure you're aware of everything that we've got going on. Some things are in the bulletin, some things I'm going to need you to write down so that you'll be aware of it. First of all, I want to let you know that from our men, our men's supper for the month of May, it's going to be Monday, May the 3rd. We've got a sign-up sheet here in the Sunday School counter and next door on the table as soon as you walk in the door. We're going to be doing steaks again this year. So we encourage you to come bring your own steak, because we're not providing that unless you just want bologna sandwiches. So bring your own steak. We're asking you to sign up so that we don't have any baked potatoes to provide, and some getting salad and things like that together for us. So bring your own steak, bring whatever salad dressing you'd like to use, and then we'll have a good time in our fellowship with that. That's going to be Monday, May 3rd at 7 p.m., okay? Another announcement is not in the bulletin. For our youth, I want to make sure that parents and grandparents know that our youth will be meeting on Sunday nights. We're beginning that tonight. So at 6 o'clock Sunday night, we'll be meeting over in the fellowship hall, just having time for our youth. I'm looking forward to it because I haven't got to spend a whole lot of time with our youth in the last several years, so I'm looking forward to being able to go over there with them and have a good time. But we encourage you to bring your youth to that, and looking forward to having a good time in Bible study and just having some fellowship time together. On the inside of your bulletin, if you look there for the opportunities of the week, notice there that this coming Wednesday night, we're having a family night supper. Looking forward to doing that. Bring your favorite covered dish. We'll do that at 7 p.m. over in the fellowship hall. Several of you have been asking us, when can we bring back family night supper? Well, we're doing it this week, okay? So bring your favorite covered dish. Bring somebody with you. It's a great time to be able just to meet new people. You don't have to listen to the preacher rant rave all night long. Just be able to enjoy time together as church family and friends. So 7 o'clock this coming Wednesday night, we'll be doing our family night supper together in fellowship hall. Also notice there at the bottom there, church council, we will be meeting next Sunday afternoon. That'll be at 4:30. So if you are one of our organization leaders, or if you're one of our committee chairpersons, if you'd like to come, we can try to go over events for the next coming months. So why should you please be there for that? On the back side of the bulletin, please notice there's a lot of things back there. Again, not going to go over everything, but I do want you to be aware, parents and grandparents, for our graduation service this year, I want to go ahead and get that scheduled for us. We're looking at doing that Sunday, May the 23rd. So if you have a high school senior or a graduating college student and they'd like to participate, we ask you to please get in touch with either me or Ms. Ann Woodhart so we can get all that stuff together and get it planned. That's going to be Sunday, May the 23rd. And then also look there on the right side with our missions focus for the month of April. We're focusing this month on the Samaritan House. Had a wonderful time this past Wednesday with Henry Miller and Ms. Tammy. They came and shared a lot of great stuff with us. Wonderful ministry in our community. We encourage you to be in prayers to how you can be involved in it. In a very simple way that we can help out is just with some of these items that are needed. We encourage you to take this month of April as you're going to your grocery stores or wherever you go out in the community. Look for some of these items, bring them in to us over there in the fellowship hall, and we'll be collecting them and giving them that, those items together over to the Samaritan House later on at the end of the month. Okay, so a lot going on there. We encourage you to jump in and be a part of that. Now, other thing that I have, Vacation Bible School. It's that time again. Right, so I want to share with you our dates for Vacation Bible School. Our theme this year is going to be Torchbearers. That goes right along with the Olympic theme. You know the Olympics are happening this summer, so our VBS goes right along with the Olympics. Our days for that is going to be June the 6th through the 9th. So that's going to be Sunday night through Wednesday. So we encourage you to come and be a part of that with us. Have your children, your grandchildren together for that. Looking forward to having a great time with that, how we can kind of split up things and make sure that we are doing things safely. So we are doing it in person this year. I'm excited to be able to do that. We've even had several folks to get in touch with Michelle, or just friends of hers, asking, are you doing Bible school in person? And can we come? Or is it just for church people? We said, no, we want you here. So invite those to come with you. We will be meeting, our first meeting will be this coming Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. We'll get together and kind of go over some things with VBS. So if you would like to help us out, then believe me, we're going to need as many volunteers as we can get in order for us to do it the way that we desire to put it on. So if you would like to help us out, come this Wednesday, 6 o'clock. That's right before we have our family night supper. So you can already be here, ready to go for that. And we'll have a good time planning out VBS. If you're interested or you want more information, get with Ms. Kim Cook. Raise your hand, Ms. Kim. Remember there, get with Ms. Kim or Ms. Ann Bookhart, and we'll get you some more information on those things, okay? The last thing that I have for you this morning. Hopefully you received this bookmark in your bulletin this morning. Everybody got one? It says, who's your one? Y'all know that I've been asking you for the last several months to be praying for one person that you don't know if they have a relationship with Christ or not. And so we're getting really serious about that right now. Over these next several weeks, we're really going to be digging into God's Word and showing, you know, what He says to us about this. So on this bookmark, what you got there, on the top of it, it says, who's your one? If you got a place where you can write the name of that individual. This is what I'm going to ask you to do. Over the next several weeks, you be in prayer as to who God would have you to be praying over. Someone that, you, that God has laid upon your heart. If you're not sure if they have a relationship with Jesus Christ or not, I'm going to ask you to write that individual's name on this top part of it, okay? You don't have to write out their full name. I know some folks want to be private on it. You can write their first name. You can write their initials. It doesn't matter. You know who they are. God knows who they are. Once you do that, I'm going to ask you just to tear that part of it off and drop it in an offering plate as you come in doors. I'm going to set up a place next door in the fellowship hall in one of our Sunday school classes where we will have these names on the bulletin board, and you can come in anytime you like. Anybody can come in and be praying over these individuals. And then we'll see how God is working and moving in those lives. I've given you some tools here to kind of help out with it. Here on the bookmark, this is 30 days of scriptures that you can have there in your Bible and be praying over that one person. So each day you can just turn to that passage of scripture, John chapter 14, verse 6, read that, be in prayer over your one as to how God would have you working and desire to maybe use you to share the gospel with that person. Now, I know that we're in a new age of technology, and some folks don't like paper, right? So I'm going to give you another tool that will help you out as far as if you're not able to do this in your Bible. You've got an app. Everybody got a smartphone, like a Samsung or an Apple phone? There's a free Bible app that's called YouVersion. Free of charge. Just download it to your Bible. I mean, download it to your phone. Pick out whichever translation of scripture you like. But also, in that YouVersion app, you can go on the search bar and type in, who's your one? And the North American Mission Board has a prayer devotional. It's a 30-day prayer guide. The same exact thing that's on this bookmark. You can do that on your phone each day. We're going to pull up that passage of scripture, read that, you pray over your one. Also, there is a Who's Your One 40-day study guide. Now, I'm not good at math, but if you'll add that up with me, that's 30 days of specific prayer over your one, and then another 40 days going a little bit deeper. That's 70 days of praying for that one person. Watch and see what God does in 70 days. There's some of you who have shared with me your stories as to the one that you're praying for, and opportunities are starting to happen. There's opportunities that people are being able to speak into those lives. There's opportunities for you to be able to talk with them over the telephone, wherever you run into God is already doing some things. We pray that God would continue that work. I encourage you to be a part of it. Like I said last week in my message, as I shared with you from Pastor John Hunt, he said that if 10% of professing Christians in just in the Southern Baptist Convention, if 10% would lead one person to faith in Jesus Christ this year, it would be the greatest evangelistic movement in the Southern Baptist Convention since the 1840s. And what did I tell you? I didn't want 10%. I'm asking all of us to participate, because all of us know one. So I encourage you to take that home with you, be in prayer as to who God would have you be praying over. Again, fill out the name, rip it off there, put it in our offering plate, and I'll be collecting those and praying with you, along with everybody else. We'll make it available for all those who want to come in and just be praying over those. It'll be a great thing to see God's faithfulness and how He answers our prayers for that. You do have your list of prayer concerns in the bulletin. I encourage you to use that little brown slip of paper if you have someone you want us to be praying for, some kind of illness, or whatever might be going on in your life. You can write that down, and we'll be praying for you this week, okay? That's enough as far as announcements go. Let's go to our worship time, amen? Let's go to Lord in prayer. Father, in the blessed name of our Savior Jesus Christ, we come before you this morning, thankful so much for this chance to be able to worship and praise you. Father, as we listened to that song just a minute ago, is he worthy? Father, absolutely, you are so worthy of all of our honor, our praise, our adoration. Lord, our commitment, our devotion. And so, Father, with those hearts of gratitude, we come before you this morning. Pray that, Father, you just touch our hearts, touch our lives, change us and mold us and shape us to be more like Jesus. Father, as we are praying together as a church family for one, Lord, one person that you would have to come to faith in Christ. Lord, we know there are many people that are without Jesus this morning. I pray that, God, you would put that burden on our hearts for that one. That one person that's in our circles, Lord, that we can begin praying over and sharing our love for you with, Lord. And I pray that God, you would work in that life. Because, Father, we know, according to your word, that it is not your desire that one person would perish in your hell. And you have made it possible for us to have a relationship with you. We give you glory for that today, Lord. Have your will and your way in our hearts during this service. We ask it in Christ's name.
Yeah. Janet's changed, huh? You'll be in prayer for Gladys today. Janet's with her. She's at urgent care, and we're going to hope for the best and that she's going to get better. Still on the rose.
about ministry and how you have to be flexible and how you have to jump around and kind of go move things around the last minute. And I'm so thankful this morning that David jumped in and helped us out with David, those that are upstairs helping us with our equipment, jumped up and did it for us. We appreciate that. It helps us be able to do a well and great ministry. So I appreciate everybody's faithfulness on that. If you got your Bibles, join with me in the book of John, chapter 4. We're going to look at just a few verses this morning. John chapter 4, verses 3 through 7. Miss Nancy, a few weeks ago, me and you were kind of standing over here in the corner, and we were talking a little bit, and I told you that I've been reading John chapter 4 for like a month. And remember, I don't know if you remember me talking to you about that or not, but I said, I can't get out of John chapter 4. And for just about 4 or 5 weeks, I spent just every day at the kitchen table just digging into John chapter 4, because God was just really, really convicting my heart over some things. And so as I read scripture and pray about things, I've got a little journal that I like to write things down in that God lays on my heart. And it's a lot of times it's spankings that God gives me, where He's pointing out areas in my life that I still fail, and areas that I still need to truly surrender everything over to Him. And I'm so thankful that God still deals with me like that. Are you thankful for the witness? They're not pleasant when we go through it, but in the end, God uses those things to draw us closer to Him and make us more like Jesus. John chapter 4 has been that for me for a while. So I just want to share a little bit with you. Okay? I just want to share what God's kind of put on my heart as to me. And I believe that He's speaking to each of us. But as we get ready to look at this passage of Scripture, did some research. I want to share this with you. Some numbers that were pretty staggering to me. I did some looking up with Pew Research, who did a recent study about the population in South Carolina. Because I know whenever we get nationwide and worldwide, those numbers get so big, they seem very impersonal. So I wanted to kind of bring it home. Let's look at South Carolina and what we're dealing with in South Carolina. Listen to this right here. This is staggering stuff. 19% of the population in South Carolina are considered nuns. Now, that's not Catholics saying that they are nuns in the Catholic ministry. That means that they, in their survey, they identified with no religious organization at all, whether it be Christian or non-Christian. I'm talking about like with Islam or Buddhism or Hinduism. 19% of the population of South Carolina said they aren't affiliated with any kind of religion at all. They didn't want no part of that. Y'all know what that translates out to? You look around you this morning, that's 1 in 5. If we were to count off every 5 people sitting in here this morning, 1 says they want nothing to do with any kind of religion at all. That's heartbreaking to me. That's a big number when we think about just our own population in South Carolina, but also in Orangeburg County, in Cordova, when you think about that. 69% of the population in South Carolina say their religion is important in their life. Now again, I'm not just talking about Christianity. Okay? I'm talking about any kind of organized religion. 69% say that their religion is important, yet only 47% say they attend at least one religious service a week. Wow, that's less than half of the population in South Carolina. I'm sure we would be even more heartbroken to find out how many of those attending a Christian worship service. Because this includes everything. Jehovah's Witness, you know, all that, Mormons, you know, all that stuff. 43% of the population said they look to their religion, Christian or non-Christian, okay? They look to their religion for guidance on right and wrong. 37% said they rely on common sense. And you know what a problem that creates, right? Because that's something that's lacking a lot these days, is common sense. That explains a lot of the problems we see going on just within our own state. People trying to use common sense. 60% stated, and this is interesting, 60% stated that right and wrong, their understanding of right and wrong, or their perspective of right and wrong, depends on the situation that they're in. It's called relativism. It means if it benefits me, then it's okay. If it's something that might harm me, something that might, you know, come against me, then it's wrong. Don't we see that a lot in our society right now? When we say that 60% say right and wrong is dependent, then it goes a little bit deeper than that. It's not just that simple. That's at least 60% of our population in South Carolina saying that there is no such thing as an absolute truth. That there's this tremendously huge gray area. That nothing is absolutely right, nothing is absolutely wrong. It just depends on how you look at it. Let me just tell you something, folks. If that's the case, we can condone just about anything, can't we? 60% saying there's no absolute right, no absolute wrong, that there's no absolute truth. That's a 60%, taking it a little bit further, that says there's no such thing as sin. And friends, just let me tell you something, okay? If people think that there's no sin, then that 60% of the population of South Carolina that sees absolutely no reason for Jesus Christ and His death on the cross and His resurrection. Because if there's no sin, we don't need Jesus. Man, that's a lot. It's a lot of people. 80% of the population of South Carolina, 80% believe there is a heaven. 80% believe there's heaven. 68% believe that hell is real. 80% believe there's heaven. 68% believe hell is real. Yet, 43% of the population of South Carolina says that you cannot believe everything in God's Word, or that the Bible is not God's inerrant word. Hey, I'm not talking about out in California and San Francisco and all them places. I'm talking about right here. You see, we don't have to look very hard, we don't have to go very far to see that there is a lot of spiritual darkness around us. Probably in your own neighborhoods, probably right across the street from our church. There is a tremendous amount of spiritual darkness. And yet, in all of this spiritual darkness around us, and people that we know, and people that we associate with every single day, how often do we ever mention Jesus? What He's done in our life. Instead, on Sunday mornings, we gather in our holy huddles. And as Christians, statewide, nationwide, can't say worldwide because I'm telling you what, there's some amazing things going on in other countries. God is doing some amazing revivals. But within across our state and across our nation, Christians are gathering this morning. And the number one concern on their hearts and minds this morning is, man, it's too hot in this church. These pews are so uncomfortable. I wish they had turned the music down. And there's not one thought given to those who are running to spend an eternity in hell right now. You're on a fast track to hell so fast you can't catch up with them. Where's the burden? Where's the burden for one person? Where's our burden for one person who's running that race to hell right now? Charles Spurgeon, I've shared many of his quotes over the years. This is something that he stated, and it's amazing. Charles Spurgeon says, if sinners be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our dead bodies. And if they perish, let them perish with our arms wrapped about their knees, imploring them and begging them to stay. If hell must be filled, let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions, so that no one goes unwarned and unprayed for. Do we have a burden for one? Do we have a burden for one? In these verses this morning, we see that in our Savior Jesus Christ. Will you stand with me? John chapter 4, verse 3 through 7. He left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour, and a woman from Samaria came to draw water. And Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." Father, in the name of Jesus, we've read your word. I pray that you would use it to mold us and transform us this morning. Use your word to call sinners to you, Lord. We ask in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you so much. You can be seated. A burden for one. We look at these verses. One thing that has always just made an impression in my mind is how, you know, the wording of this. When we look there in verse 3, he left Judea and departed from Galilee. And look at verse 4. And he had to pass through Samaria. If you've got the King James Version, I love the way it's worded because it really conveys the urgency there. The King James Version says, he must needs go through Samaria. To me, that really gives us the urgency, how vitally important it was for Jesus to pass through this area, this region called Samaria, and what a significance that was. That he had to go there. It wasn't just that it was from where he was at, Galilee and Judea, the quickest route was through Samaria, but that's not what he's talking about. Because it was so common for Jews who hated Samaritans, and I'll get more into that in a minute, but it was so common for them to hate those Samaritans with such intensity that they would travel miles around so they didn't have to go through Samaria in order to get from Judea to Galilee. Folks, that's some intense hatred, ain't it? That you would do everything possible to avoid even having to look at one. But Jesus must needs go. He had to go to Samaria. Why? Because there were people in Samaria that needed him. There were people in Samaria that needed him. And get this, they didn't even know they needed him. See, there are so many people around us right now in our everyday life, and they need Jesus. But yet, they don't even recognize it. You know, I was thinking about this the other day. I grew up in church, and many of you have grown up in church. Going to church every Sunday morning, and every Sunday night, and every Wednesday night, and every youth group meeting, and every work day. I'm telling you what, 90% of my childhood and teenage years was spent on the church campus. It was just normal. But my, how things have changed in 30 years. And now, it's not a normal thing for families just to go to church. And we've got such a skewed perception of that. So often, we just think they should be coming. And the fact is, there are generations in these homes that have never darkened the door of a church. If they don't have the faintest idea about who Jesus Christ is. They might have heard a little bit of a story about him. They might know a Christmas story. They may have heard a little bit about a resurrection. But they need Jesus and they don't even recognize that. And Jesus had such a burden for them that he must needs go to Samaria. There was this unction in Jesus that moved him. And he was guided by the Holy Spirit to go to Samaria. And one thing that God has whooped me over is there are plenty of times God has given me the unction to speak to someone. There are many times that the Holy Ghost has led me to somebody. And yet the obedience is lacking. I wonder if that's true for you. How many times has God given you the unction to go specifically someplace? To someone specific. Some individual who God desires to reach through you. There's that burning in your heart. There's a lack of obedience. I've had people to approach me and say, "Preacher, could you go see my mama in the hospital? She's not doing well. Doctors aren't giving her much time, much more time to live. And I'm not sure if she's saved or not. Would you go leave it to the Lord?" I say, "Well, I'd be glad to go visit and talk with them." Say, "Have you tried to share with them?" "Oh, no, no, preacher, I can't do that. You know, that's just a topic that she don't want to talk about with me, and it's just going to create an argument." My goodness, mama's on the way to hell. Mama's on the way to hell. We're afraid of hurting her feelings. "Preacher, my son is starting to ask some questions. Can we come over to your house and you tell him about Jesus and leading to the Lord?" Daddy, one of the greatest privileges there is in this world is to lead your children to faith in Jesus Christ. I don't want to take that privilege from you. You don't have to be a preacher to lead somebody to the Lord. Jesus felt that burden for the woman. Here's another thing that God just walked me over. Jesus got rid of all of the excuses. He got rid of every single excuse, every single reason why he should not go there. Jesus pushed all those to the side and said, I can't help but go because I love them. And there was a lot of reasons why he should not go. Okay? I mean, this relationship between the Jews and the Samaritans, it was horrible. They didn't want to be around one another. Didn't want to see each other. Didn't want to eat from the same plate, drink from the same cup. Traveled miles and miles around, traveling for days just so they wouldn't have to see each other. That's why Jesus used a Samaritan in the parable of the Good Samaritan. The Samaritan was the hero. Why? Because of the relationship of the Jews and the Samaritans. And he told them, the religious leader there, he says, which one was the neighbor? And the guy wouldn't even call out the name of the Samaritan. He said, the one who showed mercy. The one who showed mercy was the Samaritan. He wouldn't even say it. The one who showed mercy was the neighbor. And Jesus got him and said, now you go do likewise. You go do like that Samaritan did. There was a bitterness and a hatred between the Jews and Samaritans. Jesus looked past every bit of that because they needed him. And his love was so intense that it broke down every stronghold and every barrier. And yet here we are. We still look, and when I say we, I'm talking about just Christians in general. We're looking for reasons not to go to some certain people. We look for, especially, I'm telling you, God's whooping me over this stuff. I'm just telling you what he's whooping me on, okay? Especially in today's society. Y'all want some reasons to not go to some people? Come talk to me privately. I can give you some reasons I come up with to not go. And I read this and I see where Jesus loved with such intensity that it broke down every single excuse as to why I should not go to certain places and talk to certain people. I don't have to agree with them. I don't have to like what they're doing. And they don't even have to like me. But there's still no reason for me not to share the gospel with those who are in need. I'll tell you something. Jesus went to a place there in Samaria. He went to a place where he was the minority. He was the minority. He went to a place where his own people hated them. And they hated Jesus just because he was a Jew. Jesus went to a place where he was considered the privileged one. And they were the ones that were considered the lowlifes. His love. And we're looking for excuses to not go, to not share. And we find all kinds of reasons. We find race as a reason. Well, they're so much different than me, they're not going to understand me, and I'm not going to be able to say anything to them anyway. We look at religious differences. Well, they believe differently than me, so there's no reason for me to try to share. One of the things that I hate right now, and I hate this, that this is a fact in the Church of Jesus Christ today. The thing one that I hate is that we are using political views, political differences to not share. But don't get me wrong, man, I am as conservative as you can get. There's no reason for us not to reach out to those who are lost without Christ. Just because I'm conservative and you're liberal does not mean that I just sit there and say, let them go to hell, they'll figure it out on their own. Sadly, that's being said. They'll figure it out when they're in hell. They'll figure out that was wrong. It's too late then. There's no hope. And if that's truly the way we feel, then friends, I just have to ask, are you truly right with Christ? Because Scripture that we say that we believe and that we stand on, that we're going to live by that, that we're going to let God's Word guide us in every decision that we make. Scripture says that God desires that not one single person would perish without Jesus Christ. I was listening to a speaker from the North American Mission Board the other day. He made this comment, and I thought it was excellent. I want to share it with you. He said that in the last 10 years, we've done a great job. We've done a great job at Southern Baptists in defining what the gospel is. We've got a great definition for explaining what the gospel is. But we have failed in declaring it. We can define it all day long, but we can't declare it. We've got more resources right now to share the gospel than we've ever had. Share Jesus without fear. We've got the ABCs of salvation. We've got the Roman road of salvation. We've got Christian witness training, CWT. We've got the Who's Your One campaign. We got all kinds of resources to lead people to Jesus, but we lack the heart to do it. Jesus must needs go to Samaria. He had to. He was compelled to go. How in the world did Jesus do? How in the world could Jesus, just one man, make any kind of a difference at all in what was going on between these relationships between the Jews and the Samaritans? How could Jesus make, I mean, this had been going on for generation after generation after generation. It was that they had been raised up. Jews hated Samaritans, and Samaritan children were raised up to hate the Jews. I mean, it was a normal thing. How could Jesus possibly hope to make any kind of difference in that? How do we, today, how in the world can you, as just an individual, make a difference? How can you make an impact in all that we see going on in our society today? For all of those women, with the race relations that we see heating up so vividly on television today, with all of the different political views and people are against one another, and you can't even have a conversation without somebody getting their feelings hurt over something. How in the world do we as a church make a difference? How do we even make a dent in what's going on around us today? Jesus showed us how to do it. He showed us how to do it right here in these verses. And he started with one. He started with just one. There was a whole lot of Samaritans. and on their way to hell. And Jesus focused on one seemingly insignificant, adulterous sinner of a woman who nobody wanted to associate with. And that's the one he started with. That's the one he spent time with. That's the one he talked to. Again, I'll go more into it later on, but breaking all of the norms, Jesus went totally, completely out of the norm. Counter-cultural. He went against the prevalent culture of his day for one. Jesus went completely out of his way and gave his time, gave his heart, gave his energy, all that he had for one person. And when we look at her, we'd say, she wasn't worth it. And Jesus thought different, y'all. Jesus thought different. And as the Lord has been just, you know, convicted me of this for numerous weeks. Again, I was reading over this passage of scripture this week, studying it again. And it really just kind of hit me. I was driving up the road. I was going up Ford Oval Road, and had this on my mind. And it was then, and it was at that moment that God just touched my heart and said, Brian, he didn't change them all at one time. He started with one. And that hit me. Because you see, I was in the midst of trying to give God some excuses as to why I could not do some things. And God showed me, I can't change it all. But I can make an impact in one. Later on in the week, it was Thursday morning. I was going into town, had to do some running around, some errands, and was going to stop by the bank. Pulled up on the back street, going to the bank, and there was this guy in a little Chevy S10 pickup truck that was stopped in the middle of the road. And of course, as I stopped there, he's kind of in a position where it would be really hard for me to go around him. So I'm just kind of sitting there, and I'm thinking, you know, Lord, there's so much to do today. What in the world? Move this guy. When I start praying, and, you know, God, move this guy out of the way so I can get some stuff done. I don't want to be running behind. Hey, I'm being honest with you, okay? I'm being honest with you. So I get in the car and in his truck, and I heard him trying to get it cranked. The truck ain't even running. Dadgum. I've seen the guy get out of his truck, and he grabbed hold of the steering wheel and grabbed hold of the truck, and he started pushing. So I sped around him, got up a little bit ahead of him, jumped out of the car, went over to him, said, looks like you need a little bit of help. And he just looked at me so strange. So it was completely different in every way. If you catch where I'm going with that. He looked at me real suspicious. So it looked like he needed a little bit of help. And I ran in behind his truck. I said, you drive it, I'll push it. Thank the Lord it was a little less tense. I can handle that. We started pushing that truck off the road. Got it up into the parking lot. He said, this will do it right here. I said, all right. He said, I'm about to call somebody to come out here and help me. I said, have you got a telephone? He said, yeah, I got a phone. I said, okay, so maybe use mine. I'll let you call somebody. He said, no, I got it. I said, all right, so we have a blessed day. And as I went on to the bank, did my stuff there, and got going home, I was thinking about that. Can't change everything. Can't change the way things are right now. This world can't change the way things are right here in our own hometown. Can't make a big difference in that. But that one fella was sure appreciative. Somebody helped him. I can help one. What about you? Jesus went out of his way for you. That's how much he loved you. That's how much he loved you. He gave himself completely and totally so that you could be saved. Don't you know somebody else who needs that too? Maybe you're listening right now. You don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I just want to tell you, Jesus loved you so much, He left heaven for you. He left heaven for you. Went out of His way, put on flesh and bones of a man, and lived a perfect and sinless life. Because He knew that you were going to be the way you were. Okay? Let's put it that way. He knew that I was going to be the way I am. Loved you anyway. He said He didn't want you to be without Him. So He gave His life on the cross for you. Died for your sins. Was raised again on the third day. Demonstrating power and victory over all of your sin. Giving you victory over whatever your sin is. And I know each one of us have our favorite sins. And Jesus died for that too. Would you call out to Him today in faith? It's the best way you know how to. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I know You died for me. I put my faith and trust in You. I believe You died and rose again for me. I want to live for You. And my Bible says He honors that prayer. It's a prayer of repentance. What it's all about, turning away from the life we're living right now and turning to Christ and living for Him. And the great thing is, you don't have to do it by yourself. He empowers you with His Holy Spirit to help you be able to live for Him. It gives you a church family to come alongside of you and help encourage you. Would you come to faith in Christ this morning? Father, in the blessed name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray that I've been faithful to the words You've given me. I pray to God that we've heard what You've said. And Father, now we will respond in obedience, God. In obedience in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you come with us, please, our invitation?
Would you stand for our invitation, please?
Best friend, Jesus. Take this home with you. You will bookmark again on
Once that up, you write your, the name of that individual. You don't have to write the whole name, first name, or just their initials, or whatever. Be aware of that, over that one. Rip it off, drop it in the hallway, either today or next week or over the next few weeks. And I'd love to partner with you praying for that one. Let's close in prayer. Father, in Jesus' blessed name, we thank you so much for loving us so much that you pushed aside every excuse there was and you came to us. Thank you for living that perfect and sinless life for us. Thank you for giving us victory. I pray that, Father, we would go out of this place this morning and live that victory out this week and help us to share that with someone. Father, we love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, all right. Thanks for being here this morning. Y'all sing with me as we end the service.